Good morning and welcome to the Campus Church Bayview. It's so good to have you here with us, and what a privilege it is on this Remembrance Day to gather together and to have the freedom to worship because of those who have fought for our country. Later on in our service, we'll take time to pay those people respect, but in this time, I invite you to stand as we start off our time in worship.
Oh, we look to the sun.
Scripture, we see Jesus say that whoever has seen me has seen the Father. And that's in John 14, verse 9. And when Jesus came to earth, he came to reveal exactly who the Father was to us. When he died on the cross and took on all that we deserved, he demonstrated the heart of the Father. When he healed every person that approached him, whether their faith was great or small, he displayed the kindness of our Father. Jesus represented the Father in how he dealt with sickness, torment, conflict, and crisis. He showed us who the Father was and that he is good. He told us that we would face many troubles in this world, but he promised one thing, and that was to walk with us through the fire and to carry us. In the middle of the storm, we can have the joy and the peace as we anchor ourselves in the unchanging goodness of God. Let's continue to worship him this morning. Father, we thank you. And we thank you, God, that you are so good. And Father, we praise you. And thank you, that God, that your goodness chases after us in the midst of trial, in the midst of sickness. That God, that your goodness is always there because you are faithful. And we thank you, God, that you never fail to show that to us. And we praise you, Father, for all that you are, for you deserve all the glory this morning. And Father, we thank you, God, that we can come and gather and give you our very best, So in this time, we just commit the offering to you, Father, and pray that you will use it for your glory, so that many, Lord, will be able to know and experience your goodness and who you are. We thank you and praise you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated, and at this time, the ushers may come forward.
On the summit of every town and city in the Roman Greek world was a temple. A temple to a god. There was a plethora of gods. And so there was no lack of temples going around to these gods. The most well-known was this one. What is it? In Athens, the Parthenon. Built to the goddess Athena, the god of courage, the god of war. Magnificent temple. Again, probably the most well-known of all of them. Another temple that very much rivaled the beauty of the Parthenon was the temple to Artemis in Ephesus. 127 beautiful shaped columns around the outside holding up this, they're all 60 feet tall, holding up this huge stone roof, a most beautiful temple. It was situated in Ephesus. Ephesus was the gateway to the temple of Artemis. And they had tourists come from all over the known world to visit the temple. In fact, she was the backbone of their economy in Ephesus. All the merchants and the agora, they sold all kinds of memorabilia of Artemis. They sold little statuettes of Artemis. And until one day, an old preacher came along. His name was Paul. And he began to preach that Artemis was not God, that Jesus was the one and true God. And so many people began to follow his teachings that Artemis sales began to sag. And they just weren't selling the way they used to. And it resulted in a riot. And Paul was basically driven out of Ephesus. So this was a significant temple. There's nothing there today where this temple once stood except one column. Another great temple was on the summit of Pergamum. It was the temple to Jupiter. Beautiful white marble columns, and the sky always seems to be blue there, and you take a picture of it, and it just stands out. You can see what the ruins look like. Can you imagine what the temple must have looked like back at that time? Not too far from Ephesus and Pergamum, actually, quite close to Ephesus, was the town of Priene. And Priene boasted of another beautiful temple to the goddess Athena. The inhabitants of Priene lived in a harbor at the time. They wanted to build a temple that would rival the temple, the Parthenon, in Athens. Built to the same goddess, the goddess Athena, the goddess of war and courage. And so they hired Pythios, who was the greatest architect of his day. They hired him to put together a design for a temple. And he did that, a most beautiful temple. All of the stones that were dug out of the quarry were shaped at the quarry, and they were all stamped with a number. They were all numbered, and then they were brought to the site. And without a sound, they were placed according to number right in where they were supposed to go. And so this beautiful temple just quietly grew out of the earth, so to speak. And there it was, this great temple to Athena. It was dedicated by Alexander the Great. Outside the temple was a huge statue of Athena, 7 meters tall. There she was with a gold helmet, and in her right hand was the little goddess Nike, the goddess of victory, and there she stood. And people went to the temple of Athena in the town of Priene for everything. If you needed food, you went to the temple to get it. If you needed medicine, you went to Athena to get it. If you needed daycare, you went to the temple and they provided daycare. If you needed water, they went to the temple and they got water. The idea was that Athena provided everything for them. Now, you can imagine your children or grandkids are playing with their friends. And they come home one day and they ask you a question. They say to you, you know, my friends tell me that the goddess Athena is the one who lives in that beautiful temple up on the summit there. She provides everything for them. And they tell us that our God, Jesus, is not a real God because he has no temple anywhere. So where, Dad, Mom, Grandma, Grandpa, where is the temple for Jesus? Where is the temple of the one true God? You tell us there's only one true God and Jesus is his son. Jesus, the Son of God, is the true God. Where is his temple? What would you answer them? Well, I'd like to answer that question this morning. Where and what is the temple of God? Today is a mission Sunday. And so this is very much about missions. And you'll see as we move through the message that we will get to the mission that we have as the temple of God in the world today. But into beginning to answer this question, turn with me or note on the slide behind me, Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. We begin here. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" Well, they replied, "Some say John the Baptist. Others say you're Elijah. And others say you're Jeremiah or one of the other prophets." Then he asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." We've all heard that verse, an amazing confession. You are the Messiah. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Peter, that's a bullseye. That's a slam dunk. That's a grand slam. And Jesus goes on to say to him in verse 17, "You are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from human beings." No teacher taught Peter that. That was taught to him by God himself. "And now I say to you that you are Peter," which means rock, "and upon this rock I will build my church." Jesus does a play on words here. Peter, your name is Peter, means rock. "And upon this rock I'm going to build my church." I will. It's absolute certainty. There is no doubt. No matter how it looks in the darkness of our world today, He is building. The word "build" here is the future, which is also a progressive sense. In other words, he has been building, he is building, and he will continue to build his church. The important thing to note here is that Jesus is the builder of his church. Or we could say Jesus is the builder of his temple. The design, the structure, the appearance, the strength, the endurability of the temple, any temple, depends on its architect, its builder. That's why the inhabitants of Priene hired Pythios to take charge of the building of their great temple to Athena. But we have a greater builder. Our builder is the Lord himself, Jesus. Now, every builder has a foundation. And what does Jesus say the foundation is here? He says, "Upon this rock, I will build my church." What rock is he speaking about? I would venture to say that he's first of all saying that Peter and the apostles are the rock. Do you recall on the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came down? Who stood up and preached? It was Peter. Who led the charge in those very early days of the church? It was Peter. But not Peter just by himself. It was Peter and his confession that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. And in those early days in the book of Acts, it was Peter and the apostles that went out saying that Jesus is the one true God. He is the Son of the living God. He is alive. He is risen from the dead. That is what they preached. And that was the rock upon which Jesus was building his church. Peter's confession. If I turn over to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20. "Together we are his house," or his temple, "built on the foundation of" what? "The foundation of the apostles and the prophets." And then it goes on to say, "And the cornerstone is Christ Jesus himself." Every temple needs a builder. The builder is Jesus Christ. Every ancient temple had a cornerstone. In the next picture, you'll see a cornerstone. A cornerstone is simply what it says. Be one of these huge stones in the corner. And that huge stone was cut out of the quarry, was placed at a certain point, and every other stone in the building was measured from the cornerstone. It was the primary stone. Everything was measured from it. And it says here the cornerstone is Jesus, the one from whom all the other stones are measured. Because there are thousands upon thousands of other stones that go into the construction of the temple and bricks that make up the walls and the halls and the doors and the floors of the temple. Who are these stones? Verse 21, we are carefully joined together in him. We, you and I, we are the ones who are tied to the cornerstone, measured to the cornerstone, Jesus, joined together in him, becoming a holy temple for the Lord. So who are the stones of the temple? We are. It says over here in Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you, that's you and me, are the living stones, not dead stones, but we are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. So who is the temple of God? We are. We are the living stones. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. Don't you realize that all of you, plural, together are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you? You are the temple. I am the temple. Everyone who has faith in Jesus Christ, from every tribe and language and skin color, everyone who has faith in Jesus Christ is a stone in his temple, and every stone is dug out of the quarry. Every stone is shaped. You are shaped according to a divine purpose. God has a divine purpose and place for you in his temple. You are numbered, you are placed. Each has a unique place within the structure. It's amazing. It's wonderful to know that there is a divine plan for your life, that when you come to Christ in faith, he places you in his temple in exactly the place he wants you. And the Holy Spirit lives in his temple in every stone. The Holy Spirit lives in you as a living stone. Think of it. It's an amazing thought that the Holy Spirit would rather live in you than in the most ornate building on the summit of any summit in the world. Isn't that amazing? He'd rather live in you. You are his temple. And as the world comes in contact with us, they come in contact with the temple of God. We are the temple of God. We are the ones who declare the greatness of Jesus. We are the ones who declare his beauty. We are the ones who declare his power. We are the ones who declare his love. Let's go back where we started, Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16, verse 18. Now I say to you that you are Peter, which means rock, and upon this rock I will build my church. And then this phrase, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. All the powers of hell and Hades will not conquer it. The gates of hell, the gates of death will not overpower it. The next picture, you'll see me doing some teaching at a place called Caesarea Philippi, which is exactly where Jesus was when Matthew 16 was written. And I like to sit on some of these big rocks because there's these huge rust-colored rocks. At one time when Jesus was there, there was a city. There were pagan temples everywhere. This was a pagan center. This was a Gentile city. And I can see Jesus sitting on one of those big rocks and saying, Peter, you are Peter, and upon this rock, and slapping the rock, and say, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell and death will not overpower it. If you just look over my shoulder, you'll see a dark cavern. The next picture is it's a cave. It's filled in today. Back in those days, it was open. In fact, water came out of it, gushed out of it. That was the source of the Jordan River. But this cave was considered by the ancients of Jesus' day to be one of the gates of hell. There were seven of them at various places in the Roman Empire. This was one of them. And the idea that the pagans had in their minds was that when someone died, their spirit would wander over the face of the earth looking for one of the gates, one of the doorways down into hell, and that when they came close to this cave, it would act like a giant vacuum that would suck them down into the stomach of an eternal hell. Isn't that encouraging? Something to look forward to, right? It was a foreboding place. It was a scary place. And that's why I think Jesus took his disciples to Caesarea Philippi, to this very place, to ask them, who do people say I am? Who do you say I am? You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, you're right on. And I will build my church based on you men sitting here and you women around me who follow me and who confess me. And what we build, what I build through you, will be greater than the gates of hell, greater than the foreboding doorways into the underworld. It'll be greater than death itself. The power of the gospel. And this is important for us to realize, because we are up against some pretty big enemies these days. The powers of darkness are not diminishing. But Jesus says really here that the power of the gospel, the power of the church, the power of his kingdom, or the power of his temple that is growing will be stronger than the power of death. Stronger than the powers of hell. And then he says in verse 19, and I will give you, we're talking now about mission, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. What do keys symbolize? Keys symbolize authority. Because the person who has the key has control of the building. It's with the key that Jesus says, we permit and we forbid. It's with the key that you open and you shut or you lock. I believe he's saying here that where we go with the gospel, to whom we go with the gospel, we use the key and hearts are opened and they become receptive to Jesus. Where we do not go, to whom we do not go, hearts remain closed. What a huge responsibility. Think of that. To whom you go with the gospel, the key opens hearts. To whom you don't go, the heart remains closed. Keys mean authority. Keys mean heavy, heavy responsibility. Over in Revelation chapter 3, Jesus talks about these same keys to a church. It's called the church in Philadelphia. Revelation 3, verse 7, write this letter to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. Jesus spoke to John in a vision. And the book of Revelation is that vision. But it's really written to seven churches that existed in Asia Minor, which is Turkey today. One of them was a church in a town called Philadelphia. And Philadelphia was a missional city because it was on the Royal Persian Road, one of the key highways of the ancient world. Philadelphia was really the beginning of that highway. It went across the upper plateau of Anatolia, central Turkey today. It went out toward India, to Asia. It was the doorway to the rest of Asia. Philadelphia was the center, was a center of Greek culture and language. And it was from Philadelphia that Greek culture and Greek language was spread far and wide. You see, the city was a missional church. It was from the city of Philadelphia that Greek culture spread out to the rest of the world, at least going east toward Asia. And I believe Jesus is saying to his church here, you are to be a missional church where the gospel goes out to the rest of the world. Verse 7. Here's the message he gives to the church in Philadelphia. This is the message from the one who is holy and true. The one who has, what? The keys. The key of David. But to whom has he given the keys? To us. He's the one with the key. What he opens, no one can close. And what he closes, no one can open. I know all the things you do, and I have opened a door for you, and no one can close it. You have little strength, yet you obeyed my word and did not deny me. You have little strength. And yes, when it comes to such matters, we do not rely on our strength and our ability. We rely totally on the strength and the ability of God, the Holy Spirit. But he says here, when I open a door, neither man nor devil can shut it. When we use his keys to open doors, neither man nor devil can shut it. And we begin to discover that God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. Because we have keys that open hearts. And the keys have been given to us by Jesus. When I was pastoring over at Bathurst, when we first built the building, for that very first Sunday, I made sure there was a little sign above the doorway as you go out. Maybe some of you remember what that sign is. What is it? That's right. I made sure it was up there for the very first Sunday. Just a little sign, but I would remind everyone about it every so often. It said, you are now entering the mission field. Because we often think of the mission field as some place way over there somewhere. A place that I have no access to, but that's not true. The mission field is right outside the door of every church building. And as you go through that door, exit door on the way out, the door opens and you have an open door to the world. When we leave this theater this morning, you will open a door. And when you open that door, I want you to remember something, that you are opening a door to your world. It's an open door, not a closed door. It opens up, and you step through that door into your home. Some of us have homes that are true mission fields. To your family, to your street, to your school, to your workplace, to your friends, or to any part of the world that Christ might call you to. And you have special keys to use. You see, we go armed, not just in our strength, we go armed with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The Bible says the gospel has the power to save everyone who believes and to change lives. Powerful. We go armed with the power of the gospel on our lips, with the Holy Spirit in our lives, with the keys in our hands, and with the strength and the ability and sufficiency of the living Christ in our hearts. That's what we go armed with. You know, there's the next slide, you'll see a picture here. One of the places that you go to in Israel today, in Jerusalem, it's a possible site of the Lord's resurrection. They're not absolutely sure. Really doesn't matter, the place. The fact is, he's alive, and that's what makes the difference, right? But when you go into the garden tomb, and you turn around, on the door you see this. He is not here, for he is risen. And that changed everything. Jesus' enemies placed a guard at the door of this tomb. And the purpose of that guard was to keep robbers from breaking in. And they could stand there and they could keep robbers from breaking in. The trouble was they couldn't keep the living Christ from breaking out. And they weren't expecting that. And it scared them to death. And they ran. They had never experienced a resurrection. Those guards became the first eyewitnesses to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ came out of the tomb. And he is alive today. Alive. And that changed everything. We go into our mission field armed with the keys and with the power of the living Christ within us. Jesus is alive. And that means anything can happen. Amen? Anything can happen. Dear Heavenly Father, open our eyes to the world around us. Our world. And Lord, to realize that we truly are armed with the life-changing gospel of Jesus, with the presence of the Holy Spirit, with the keys of the kingdom that opens hearts, and with the power and the sufficiency of the risen Christ. And help us to go forward through the open door in humble dependence upon you to be a faithful witness to whomever we come in contact with, whether it be on our street, in our home, or our workplace, or thousands of miles away in a place where they've never heard about Jesus. We ask this in your name. Amen.
I invite you to stand with us as we close off our time in worship this morning.
Thank you.
continue to remind us that this week as we go on with our weeks, Lord, and as we go and continue in the mission that you called us to, and that's to grow your kingdom and to spread your word, that God, that we are not children of fear, that God, that you have prepared us with the courage needed to do what you have called us to do. We just thank you and praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. Go in peace, and may you have a great week.